Television. Nothing brings us together more than the small screen in the corner of the living room. It's entertained us, made us smarter, and to my mind, brought us some of the most potent music of our times. It's given us a lifetime of golden tunes and has touched more of us, and arguably more profoundly, than the greatest pop classics. TV composers are unsung heroes, and this series is my celebration of them and the shared musical history they've left us. The music that became the real soundtrack to our lives. But when it came to the score, the music that drives the narrative of drama and documentary, it took a while to get there.
How do you know?
We saw them together.
Today, in the gardens.
My early memories of TV drama are just this. Talking heads and stilted dialogue, with nary a hint of a rich musical soundtrack. No, what gripped me on TV was seeing this, the movies. The big screen was so much more exciting, even on the small screen. And the films that I loved in my early years were actually a hangover from the cinema's fight back against TV in the first place. They were made to stun with scale. And the musical scores that drove them made me want to become a composer. How, for example, could television possibly compete with the epic widescreen drama of Lawrence of Arabia? Maurice Jarre's fantastic music sounded lush and powerful, even coming from a TV speaker. It stirred something in me and inspired my love of film soundtracks. Flash forward to today, and it's almost the norm for all of our TV dramas and documentaries to look and sound like cinema. Not least the score for one of the biggest hits of recent years, the truly cinematic blockbuster, Game of Thrones. In this episode, I'll be finding out how music escaped the confines of the box in the living room corner. To take us deeper, and with greater scale and impact, into the fictional and real-life dramas that played out on our screens. I'll be exploring how a brilliant score can add emotion and tension to documentary storytelling.
It was a lovely thing to write for. It is epic. You could be listening to Ben-Hur or something, you know.
Questioning how far a television score can and should go to express emotion without sounding manipulative. And meeting the Mavericks, who are transforming the sound world of big-budget popular series.
Good night, ladies.
Kiss your mom night for me.
That's like, okay, we're like a circus or something, and now it's like, no, I'm being chased by something.
That's great.
If you've never realized how much music shapes and indeed controls the way we watch TV, then open your eyes and your ears and be prepared for this wild ride into the world of TV scoring. When I was a teenager, TV was still black and white and fundamentally small screen. Where was the excitement, the colour, that could transport me from the living room and really submerge me in action, like the movies did? The answer lay with a French adventurer. Back in the 1960s, one of the few things on TV that, for me, could match the excitement of a trip to the cinema was the undersea world of Jacques Cousteau. It was the music that did it. Walter Scharf's main theme was a mixture of action and awe, and the big chord that finished it blasted me into a world of excitement and glamour, both above and below the waves. ¶¶ In his signature red hat, aboard his refurbished World War II minesweeper, Calypso, equipped with an onboard lab, Cousteau was every young boy's daredevil. But it was feature film luminary Shaft's action hero score that really transformed the nautical documentary footage into a fully dramatic, exhilarating story. This was TV music at its classiest. It brought the sophisticated orchestration of Hollywood to a TV documentary. Walter Scharf dramatized Cousteau's exploits by injecting sonic wonder into an alien world few had actually experienced, to the point that it didn't even feel to me like documentary at all. These were stories of high adventure. And that raises a crucial point. How far does the TV score change, or perhaps manipulate, the very nature of what we're watching? In 1973, the trauma of World War II was still a recent memory in the minds of many TV viewers.
What was it like to have been in a concentration camp? What was it like to be in an occupied country? And so it just sort of eliminated the idea that there would be a march and it would be heroic.
So where did you start with this huge project? Was there a particular episode that gave you an easier way into the subject?
The very first episode we tackled, which was the German bombardment of Poland and the invasion of Poland. And so there were these exciting shots of the going on. So there I go, and I went, real attack music. So I'd record that and go into the booth, you know, to discuss it with my colleague. And they're also going, and I said, what's the matter? And he said, well, it's so dramatic. Yes. By selecting areas in which I could let it all out, you know, let the emotion ring out. And then there were areas where, throughout the series, I kept thinking, I'm waiting for a moment to exploit my theme. Until finally, the penultimate episode was about the immediate aftermath, the fact version of the theme, and one that was just going for haunting rather than
memorializing.
Yes, yes, and also a yearning.
Broadcast in 1973, at the height of the Vietnam War and the troubles in Northern Ireland, the series reflected a growing discontent with conflict around the world. And Carl Davis hit the right tone musically, elegiac and dignified, devoid of triumphalism. While the score for the World at War elevated TV documentary into a cinematic saga, music had not yet found its voice in TV's fictional dramas. Early 70s productions, such as ITV's Antony and Cleopatra, were merely dipping their toes into the idea of a dramatic score. With music used intermittently to elevate the mood of what were, in effect, stage plays on the telly. Within just a few years, all that was to change. Drama stepped out of the studio and, with ITV flush with cash, moved into the realm of big-budget, movie-style serials. Geoffrey Bergen, a composer steeped in English classicism from Purcell to Arnold Bax, became one of the first composers to bring symphonic scoring to primetime storytelling. And boy, did it make an impact. Set against the dreaming spires of Oxford, Brideshead Revisited was a landmark in TV drama and TV scoring. Starring Jeremy Irons as Charles Ryder, a World War II army captain lost in nostalgia for the carefree days of his youth, and his old flame, Lady Julia. Bergen unites this enormous series by coming up with a piece of music which is a wonderful opening for every episode. But the chord sequence he uses, he repeats again and again and puts it under the variations he's going to do. So, for instance, when we have Lady Julia's theme, which is very beautiful, keening, somehow vulnerable as well, we get it as this. Ryder's own theme, we get this wonderful use of a minor version of the same idea. So that when we come to the end of the whole series, now his theme and Lady Julia's theme dovetail. It sums up everything that Brideshead was about. Heritage, memory, loss, love. And that's what comes out in that wonderful final music.
I remember being very taken with Brideshead Revisited, and I imagine if you played the music to that, I would kind of burst into tears. But we are very good at dramas about class.
Yeah.
And the strings of Brideshead. You're not allowed strings if you work in class, are you? Because you think full orchestral sweep, don't you? There's a tendency to think about upper-class lives as incredibly, obviously, you know, more repressed. So all the drama is in the music, isn't it?
Thematically and musically, Brideshead chimed with the values of Thatcher's conservative views of the world. Here's a Britain looking to 80s economic prosperity, yet almost nostalgic for the old days of empire. This was a golden age for Granada Television. Fenton had just completed writing the music for Richard Attenborough's biopic Gandhi, a film approaching the scale of Lawrence of Arabia. Is there a definable difference between writing for a 2-hour film and a 14-hour series?
It would be an incredibly ambitious sort of aim to be able to totally define the arc in the way that you have to or try to in a 2-hour film. Longer connective tissue.
Where do you start getting into the real nub of the film? Scale. Hollywood may have claimed the big screen, now we had claimed the small screen. With Jewel in the Crown, George Fenton brought an immersive film score to television drama. And that was the secret to its success. So, could a similar approach work for, say, a wildlife series? The BBC's Natural History Unit was second to none, and they too were starting to use music to elevate the scale of their increasingly ambitious productions. David Attenborough's series Living Planet explored how various organisms adapted to life in extreme environments. For its day, the score was pretty extreme too. Elizabeth Parker of the BBC Radiophonic Workshop used cutting-edge electronics to create a stark and mystical soundscape that made the Earth feel alien and inhospitable.
Oh. First of all, for that very first shot, which is a marvellous shot of a sun coming up. It's red, it's glowing, and you've got the waves across there. And I wanted a great feeling of power, but also a sort of celestial feel also. The first thing I thought of using was something that sounds vaguely like this, I think. There. Add a bit of echo. It's just there. It's very strong. It's very powerful. I mean, I used hisses for my voice. I scratched the mic. I found all sorts of weird sounds on the synthesizer and put them all together. And then, of course, the other very important element is silence. Now, the producer said to me on this cue that he wanted it to be like Psycho. Incredible suspense as we go up this leg.
Elizabeth Parker's score built suspense through texture, but with their next globe-trotting series, the Natural History Unit wanted to ramp up the jeopardy and the scale.
For his new series, Trials of Life, David Attenborough and his intrepid crew had travelled 250,000 miles around the planet to capture the most critical stages in the life cycles of innumerable species. The producers wanted to commission a score that would bring out all the drama in the footage that they'd shot. So, of course, they turned to a composer used to dealing with the long-form narrative and drawing us, the viewer, deep inside those dramas.
After his success with Jewel in the Crown, composer George Fenton was brought on to introduce the musical language of cinema to a wildlife documentary.
Behaviours were very small and short, so that there wasn't that much opportunity for sort of longer narrative pieces. But occasionally there was. And I found that my film head was starting to have an effect on how I was writing some of these sequences. People absolutely incandescent about the disrespect that this music had shown for the lobsters, and why had I characterized them in this way?
The oceans cover 7/10 of the Earth's surface, and in some places are less well explored than the surface of the moon. Shooting Blue Planet was a Herculean task that took 5 years and involved much longer narrative sequences. So George Fenton's music had to literally go deeper and sound more expansive than any previous natural history series.
With Blue Planet, the word you think of is epic. Were you aware of scoring to an epic degree, as if you were scoring Lawrence of Arabia?
It wasn't totally my ambition. It was the ambition of Alistair Fothergill, who produced it. He said, look, the thing is that I want you to use a big orchestra and write a film score. It had epic things about it. You could be listening to Ben-Hur or something, you know. It is epic.
George Fenton's score for Blue Planet seized upon our instinctive connection to blockbusting movie soundtracks and ran with it.
If you love music, and I love music, then music's absolutely the portal straight into an emotion. So I like the magic. And, you know, there's still something amazing about how the animals are filmed. Music is the thing that accesses the emotions you can't speak or you can't write, you know, and those things are incredibly fundamental, you know, and wildlife is one, I have to say.
In a way, it's almost like you'd be writing for a silent film or something, that you needed to say, he's a bad guy, or, you know, he's about to try and attack him or her or what, and that this is the story. And to be quite, you know, full on the nose, as it were, about
the story shifts, the narrative, when the amping up the action. And I think that that was what was key about the Blue Planet.
If there were complaints about the lobsters, how come there were no complaints about the way you given personality to the Blue Planet?
There were people who said that I negatively stereotype sharks. And my answer is very, very straightforward and simple. It's not the music that makes the choice about what a character is in a film. It's the camera that is telling you, this is a predator, or this is a dark force that's arriving. They're telling a story, you have to illustrate that story. And therefore, not guilty, it was me. It's not me. It's not me that negatively stereotyped the shark.
It's interesting that where Walter Scharf placed us with Jacques Cousteau as an outsider going into the water and the adventure of going into the water, what George does is place us inside that water with all this life going on around us, very much in the same way that John Williams famously did, teaching us all to be terrified in Jaws. But this isn't the same kind of jeopardy. This is a beautiful jeopardy. And what's really interesting is that George does it as simply as possible. This is TV composition, two notes. Now, the reason those notes work is because there's no connection between those two notes within the normal harmonic system. They're completely separate from each other. And so using them like that puts us slightly off balance. This is a beautiful world within which Jeopardy happens to be where we are at that moment, and we are right in the middle of it. Blue Planet was an unmistakable turning point. Its edge of the seat score raised the bar for television music, bringing it from the background to the foreground. But here comes the dilemma. Have we entered an era where perhaps music is doing too much on TV? Manipulating rather than gently guiding us? And this question is particularly pertinent when it comes to scoring someone's real life story. Composer Nainita Desai's sensitivity was put to the ultimate test when she was asked to provide a score for a uniquely personal documentary. For Sama is a first-hand account of the civil war that engulfed Syria in 2011, filmed by Waad al-Kateyab, a young journalist living in Aleppo. The music had to tread carefully in the face of such raw imagery.
Initially, the brief was to write a Hollywood-esque, rich cinematic score. But as the edit evolved, the decision was made eventually that what this film is really about is the relationship between a mother and child. And so the film transitioned from this epic uprising war film into something much more intimate, and that had a domino effect on the music.
Sama. Sama.
There's this pinnacle moment in the film where Waad gives birth to Sama. And the music has to reflect that tenderness, but it cannot manipulate the emotions of the scene. The function of the music was to capture the pathos the hope, the tragedy, the angst and the torture of what was happening in Wad's life at that time. So it's absolutely crucial to underplay and restrain the, and hold back on the music, which is can be the hardest thing.
Nainita Desai's score was an exercise in restraint, somewhat rare in today's documentary landscape. At the absolute opposite end of scoring real-life storytelling is the phenomenon of hyper-glamorous American reality TV, where wall-to-wall music has become crucial in creating drama out of even the smallest crisis. How do you bring tension to Ladies Who Lunch?
Can you pull up my bra straps?
To find out, I've come to meet reality TV's go-to composers, signature tracks, creators of scores for blockbuster series such as Real Housewives and Keeping Up with the Kardashians. And today, they're teaching me, hands-on, the tricks of their trade.
This is where I want to get you involved. Okay,
sure.
So we have the meat and potatoes.
I'm having a go at creating one of their signature attention-grabbing themes.
All right, my friend.
Does it need to also fit just as a kind of chord progression across what you're doing, or can it be kind of like, you know...
But I don't want to limit you, but I'm thinking for this, yeah, we just keep it simple.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah, do that.
Like 2, 3, here we go.
I feel as though in unscripted television, music is another cast member. It's the barometer. It tells you how the temperature of the drama.
I'm going to add one more thing, maybe like a...
Signature tracks take the sounds of urban pop music, crisp drums and deep bass, and spin them into the oral equivalent of reality show bling.
You're using the top and bottom end of the range. There's a lot of top in there, there's a lot of bass left in there. Is that because you're assuming that any dialogue is going to happen across the middle of the range?
Yeah, I love that observation. I think so. I think I didn't even really think about that till now. So, but subliminally, yeah, there's a lot. There's high ends, there's low ends, and you're right, that the dialogue would be the middle.
You asked me a question. Let me answer.
Well, there's no need to get upset.
No, I am upset because I'm...
In this kind of TV, it seems to me that music has to work much harder than in conventional documentary.
You're not deliberately cold. You're inherently cold.
Whatever.
It's elevating the game. If you have two people are arguing, you may have seen that before. But if you add some dramatic music and a big sting out and the act ends, then you're going to go feeling like, holy, I got to tune in for the next act.
1, 2, 3, 4,
So crucial is it to creating the narrative that for just one series, Signature Tracks might have to conjure up more than 900 pieces of music.
Did you get that?
Yeah, I got it.
Okay,
got it.
Cool.
So we take that. All right.
What do you imagine that for?
That, like a lunch meeting going really bad, or like someone breaking up with someone, and it starts off a talk, and then it maybe turns into a fight, a girlfriend.
Dramatic scene closer.
For sure. Yeah.
The sound of 21st century popular music has revolutionized reality documentary. But could a pop song, its music and lyrics played out as if on a record, revolutionize TV drama? Well, remarkably, yes. And it did so over 40 years ago. When Andy Mackay of art rock outfit Roxy Music was tasked with scoring With Songs, a radical primetime series, it opened the doors to a whole new form of TV storytelling. Everybody wants to sing in the Rock Follies. Rock Follies followed the misadventures of a fictional girl group, the Little Ladies. But with musical sequences shot in a studio, far removed from the realism of 70s TV drama, stylistically it took its cue from the movies, most particularly that bastion of artifice, the Hollywood musical.
How
Had music always been central to you in telling a story?
Music was always important, but I hadn't really thought about television as a place to do a musical. Yeah. And Rock Follies became the chance to do it.
So, Andy, having come out of the rock world, how did you find writing pastiche songs that could be from a load of other genres?
I loved rock and roll, I loved soul, and there was a certain fashion for looking back at pre-war musicals in the mid-60s, you know, the kind of, so that Busby Berkeley films, there was a little bit of that sort of nostalgia thing, so I was kind of quite familiar with that.
Busby Berkeley's Gold Diggers use stagecraft, choreography and song to make a social comment. Rock Follies borrowed its look wholesale, updating it for the feminist politics of the Little Ladies.
Well, a lot of the songs in Follies don't move the narrative, but they deepen your understanding of character and situation.
Mm. She rides in her bed in her sweltering room in Greek Street.
It's the skillful musical artifice of songs like Hot Neon that sugar-coated subjects primetime drama had rarely tackled: gay characters, feminism, and sex.
How out there was Rock Follies going out at 9 p.m. prime time on a major channel?
I mean, we had an anti-royal song.
One long party for Her Majesty.
What was going on was making me so angry, because one of the themes of both series, it was a background of economic deprivations, tensions in the society, and I felt the Jubilee was the perfect way of looking at the escape from the reality of what was happening in the society. It just seemed like we were capturing a certain kind of an aspect of life that maybe even good television wasn't actually dealing with.
But keep well away from my street. 10% are out of work.
Rock Follies was MTV as imagined by ITV. A good times, bad times musical melodrama that foreshadowed the arrival of the age of the pop video.
About the Silver Jubilee.
When your toe bone connected to your foot bone connected to your...
But within just a few years, another radical dramatist, master of the surreal Dennis Potter, would become renowned for his use of the language of the movie musical to tell a much darker kind of story.
Original recordings of popular songs which the cast mimed to.
After you've gone, there's no denying.
Potter is the master manipulator, turning on a sixpence from nostalgia to terror. The Scarecrow is the sadistic village schoolmistress of Marlowe's youth, a toxic memory dressed up as a seductive 20s jazz song. The song transforms acute pain into an earworm, making it all pop out of the screen and rattle your bones.
You knew better than you ever had.
The directors of the American New Wave, such as Martin Scorsese and Francis Ford Coppola, made their name with gritty dramas that mined their roots in 1950s and 60s pop and rock music.
You woke up this morning, got yourself a gun. Your mama always...
Almost 30 years on, a TV maverick jumped on this idea. His passion for pop music would change TV drama beyond recognition.
Making a new drama about Italian-American New York mafiosi was always going to take a bit of nerve. It was, after all, Scorsese and Francis Ford Coppola's territory. So when David Chase came to make his mobster soap opera The Sopranos, he decided to confront that legacy head-on. He took Scorsese's toolbox, 27 actors from Goodfellas, and drove them across the state line to the mundane and unromantic landscape of New Jersey. David Chase used music to evoke a state of mind
as much as on-screen action. His Jersey mobster was a gangster in psychotherapy, turning the machismo of the mafia henchman on its head. So while this Pacini aria is symptomatic of a streetwise Italian-American drama, the twist is that here it's soundtracking neurosis and doubt.
Martin Scorsese and Dennis Potter had used the soundtrack of their own lives to take us to a specific place and time. But David Chase was having to handle a huge number of characters from different generations. So he developed an eclectic jukebox of songs to take us deep into the mind of all those different characters.
Inside Tony Soprano's mind, it's the songs of his youth that give us an instant snapshot of his rock and roll attitude. Where did the idea of using different genres of music to establish the character of the series come from?
I had been in a band, in a rock and roll band, and I began to get interested in movies. Then I went to see Mean Streets, and there you had the use of needle drops or records as the score. And the thing about Mean Streets that struck me was how good it was. So it seemed, by the time I got to do Sopranos, it seemed very natural to me, although there were, it wasn't being done in TV.
Chase reinvented the whole genre of the mafia saga, made famous by movies like the Oscar-winning Godfather series, with a subversive, counterintuitive use of song. What would you choose to soundtrack an Italian-American mafioso baptism? A poem by the gangly punk bard of Salford, John Cooper Clarke?
The bloody cops, the bloody keys, the bloody keep it bloody clean, the bloody shoes, the bloody swine, the bloody drawers, the bloody line, the bloody fun and bloody games, the bloody kids, the bloody blames, and nowhere to be bloody found anywhere in Chicken Town.
I had heard that song once, about 5 years before, and we hadn't really done any Godfather ripoffs, but that one ended in the church with the baptism and all that, and I thought, well, what are we going to do now? It's just like the Godfather. And so John Cooper Clarke and evidently Chicken Town came into my head.
The Sopranos is full of such bold moments where songs transcend mere scene setting, none more so than the crooner that opens season two.
When I was 17, it was a very good year.
This is arguably the most audacious scene in the history of TV drama, playing one Frank Sinatra song uninterrupted by dialogue for almost 5 full minutes.
We'd hide from the lights.
Did you have to fight for that? And was it something you knew would work?
Yeah, I knew it would work. I had to fight with the Sinatra family. It was really, really hard to get that from the Sinatra family. It was really difficult. You know, they were tough. They wanted to know what the scene was going to be. They weren't sure they should do it. And, you know, for the Sinatra family to be associated with the mob, well, how ridiculous, you know.
It poured sweet and clear.
But it works brilliantly.
It was a very good year.
Hearing Old Blue Eyes over a sleepless Tony gives this mobster an air of vulnerability and sympathy.
Would you be able to do such a thing again?
No. As a matter of fact, I mean, we're doing a movie now, a Sopranos movie, doing the same kind of thing with music. And I really believe this is my last time. I can't do it anymore. I've used up every note in my head.
After 8 daring years, the very final scene of The Sopranos was the ultimate TV cliffhanger.
I went ahead and ordered some for the table.
As Tony is transported by another song from his youth, Journey's Don't Stop Believing, something truly audacious occurs.
Sweet light,
He reaches to stop the jukebox, and the screen cuts to black. The song, and perhaps Tony himself, are abruptly terminated. The Sopranos was a pioneer in the shifting landscape of how we now watch TV. The box set, streaming, the binge watch. And with it, the need for the score to become the very identity of the mega-series.
In 2007, a home movie streaming service launched in the US, which directly challenged Hollywood and all the other major TV broadcasters. This new kid on the block quickly expanded globally.
The phenomenon that is Netflix is now synonymous with TV dramas that match their back catalogue of Hollywood blockbusters for budget and scale. And unlike commercial TV with their captive subscription audience, they can afford to take risks not just with the storytelling, but with its score.
Enter Stranger Things, a story of a bunch of kids investigating paranormal activities in their suburban hometown in 1983. The series conjured a spellbinding world on the foundations of the movies the kids would have seen at the time. E.T., Close Encounters, Stand By Me, Poltergeist, Jaws, and the combined works of directors like George A. Romero, John Carpenter, and writers like Stephen King, all topped off with a healthy dose of Cold War paranoia.
The series capitalized on the nostalgia for the excitement these films brought us, and they got every detail right. From the bikes to the walkie-talkies, this was a cool, spooky retro show. But to translate it into a global hit, it was critical to find the right soundscape.
Get back here! I'm gonna kill you!
I'll take your X-Men 134!
Series creators the Duffer Brothers picked up on the movie trend where sound design, the use of processed effects...
So you're hearing the bass of the Mellotron.
Yes.
...is as important as a conventional musical score.
That's like, okay, am I like a circus or something? And now it's like, no, I'm being chased by something.
That's great.
And so took the bold step of bringing in two electronic whiz kits to electrify the very sound of TV.
The Duffer Brothers, they were drawn to the fact that we're referencing a time period, but not just trying to go so cliche and just completely recreate it.
There's something about our music that still sounded modern to them.
In the theme Star Court, the mall where much of the action takes place, listen to how underneath that huge electronic production,
the jump scares, the horror, the terror, that harsh, harsh sound, if you strip that away, you come to 80s synth pop. And a very warm, melodic one at that.
Oh, come on.
If you strip away all the electronics from Star Court, you get this chord sequence.
Bittersweet, nostalgic piece that carries all the illicit romance of a late-night trip to the mall.
You're late.
I'm sorry.
Again.
We're gonna miss the opening.
Yeah, if you guys keep whining about it, let's go.
If you guys keep whining about it,
Just please stop talking, dude.
Now, that wall of sound, albeit 80s come 2010, 2020, actually has a feel of another wall of sound, Phil Spector's wall of sound. It sounds like one of those doo-wop numbers that Spector might have produced in the 60s that sounded like that with that chord sequence. Now, that's no coincidence. That's what they were pitching for. There is a warmth at the center of that score, which is about those kids, which makes us want to care about them, which makes us feel how joyous they feel things. It's a very human warmth which really elides alongside that harsh electronic world in which anything terrifying can happen.
Stranger Things' retro 1970s electronic mood manages to captivate a young 21st century audience, but it wouldn't have had quite the same impact if it had come out of a 70s TV set. Because TV technology has changed the playing field. Bigger screens and sophisticated sound systems have lured audiences away from the old-style picture house. Our not-so-small screens command TV composers to compete with the epic bombast of the Hollywood blockbuster. Game of Thrones posed a huge challenge for composer Ramin Djawadi. He had to musically map a complex terrain of parallel plot lines and 20 main characters right from the off. What was your way in to Game of Thrones?
The show is very dark. Any character can die at any point, and so that gets quite emotional. There's these different houses that they get separated, and if somebody dies, or even just being separated, it gets quite emotional. So the main instrument that I thought could be perfect for this was the cello, because I liked how moody the cello can be.
I think of the cello as a very romantic instrument, and it's used in the series to a haunting, keening effect. But with 8 seasons to score, Ramin deployed an impressive arsenal of exotic instruments to give identity to specific characters and clans. He used a didgeridoo for the wildlings, an Armenian duduk for the Dothrakis, and when Arya first got her own theme, Ramin played it himself on one of his favourite instruments, the hammered dulcimer.
Someone who uses a lot of very interesting, genuine, real instruments as well as electronics in the work that you do.
There might be certain instruments from around the world that I might play this instrument differently than it might actually be properly played, and therefore I get different sounds out of it. And I think that's over the years has become part of my sound.
Ramin uses an exotic sound palette, yet curiously, he fell back on one instrument that we might think to be too much of a cliche.
The piano was kind of out of the question, because for the fantasy world that we lived in, we all thought that this probably is not the right instrument, and therefore it was never even discussed. But what's beautiful in something like with Game of Thrones and a TV show, when you have multiple seasons to develop your score, because that's something I really enjoy doing, is taking themes, setting them up, and then cut to season 6. Such a powerful scene that until that point we hadn't had anything like it. It was 10 minutes long, there was hardly any dialogue. And so we said, this needs to be something different here. And that's how then the piano came up, and we thought, well, if we use a different instrument that in 6 seasons we have never heard before, you just play one note and the audience will go, wait, what's happening here, right? This is, something is off here. And so that's how that idea came about. The beauty of film scoring is that you're able to manipulate the audience in a subconscious way, you know, and Game of Thrones was the perfect playground for that.
Game of Thrones, like so many 21st century dramas, brought not just the visual scale, but the dynamic score of the blockbuster movie into the domestic living room. And thus, television no longer plays David to cinema's Goliath. It has conquered the challenge of the movie soundtrack. And moreover, it has conquered us. TV theme tunes were the social glue that united the nation and became an alternative hit parade. And TV music is seared into our brains. Do the shake and back and put the fresh man back. Even the briefest of advertising jingles or station idents have become earworms that never fade in our memory. And that is my biggest takeaway from this subject. TV music, often without our even noticing it, has not just underscored our world, it's shaped it, and us along with it. Thank you for joining me. Good night.